it would grind my ears.
The music perfect, his voice sometimes perfect, but then there were certain notes he would hit where I'd be like, okay, that's a rap. Like the, I can't. Hello everybody. Today we're going to be discussing some visual K bands that I was not able to get into at first. This idea came to me because I was in some forum. I think last weekend I was in this forum and I was reading about bands that people hated. I saw this user just tearing into X Japan, like ripping them to shreds, like Toshi's voice sucks, the music isn't even that good. And I was just like, wow, what a terrible opinion. I completely understand that everybody has different musical tastes. Some people like certain types of voices. Others don't. It kind of reminds me of the feeling I had when I was in middle school, how I would find certain bands and the voices would not kind of be my thing, but they'd eventually grow on me. And I was like, have I ever talked about the groups that I didn't like at first? I don't think so. So yeah, that's what we're gonna do. We're gonna talk about groups that I could not stand or didn't really care for, and now I actually listen to them, like, a lot. I have a feeling that some of these bands that I mention are going to be bands that other people had to have grow on them too. I just have a feeling I'm not going to be the only one for all the bands that I talk about. So if there are any bands that you guys see in this video that also had to grow on you too, just let me know in the comments. Also, my voice is a little weird today. I don't know if I'm coming down with something. Probably should have brought water. So if my voice sounds unusually deep or sounds kind of odd, it's because apparently I'm dehydrated. I'm really thirsty, but I can't leave where I am, so let's get started. I'm so excited. So I'm gonna start with the old bands first because I really want to knock this cluster out. The bands aren't really super similar, but they were from a super similar time period. I was not alive, so it's all a blur to me. I want to talk about Bucktick, Lunacy, and we'll talk about X Japan last. I'm brainstorming the timeline in my head. Bucktick was a band that I was not into for the longest time. I did like the song Dress, but I did not get into Bucktick's music fully until I started listening to the opening for Shiki. I kept playing Kuchizuke over and over and over again. Through listening to Kuchizuke, I started diving more into their music, and then I found their lives on YouTube. Finding their lives pulled me more into their music. I would say it was probably around the middle of high school that I started listening to a lot of Bucktick. And when I tell you I started listening to so much, like every single live I would save. So that's why lives are very important and YouTube needs to stop taking them down, because literally that's how some people are discovering visual K bands, through watching live. Still today, even though I really love Bucktick, y'all know I love Atsushi Sakurai, even though I really, really like his vocals, as far as sitting down and listening to a Bucktick album, like fully, that's probably not gonna happen. I have a lot of different songs I love from them, but they're scattered on different albums. Most of the time when I am listening to Bucktick, I'm listening to live performances, not necessarily stuff that's just on the album. Watching the older performances and compared to the more recent performances before he passed, everything, it's just like a timeline of perfection. To me, like, some of the lives are just so beautiful. And of course, maybe it's because I'm younger. When I go back to the albums, with the exception of a couple songs that have really grown on me, or a couple songs that I feel like have lasted the test of time, of course it still sounds dated. There's a gigantic chunk of Bucktick's music that I do not listen to. I will be the first to admit that. If I'm not mistaken, Bucktick also did the ending for Shiki. I don't know if it was the first ending or the second ending, so I was like, okay, obviously I've just been listening to the extremely dated stuff. That's the stuff I've been coming across. So let's dive into this more. Even songs I didn't really like or care for on the album were amazing live. They've just done a really good job at maintaining the life of their songs. It's just amazing. So yeah, Bucktick is the first old band I wanted to start off with that I was not into at first, because when I first found them, I was just like, this music sounds old as hell. So now we're going to talk about Lunacy, the second old band in this cluster. A lot of people say Lunacy was or is no longer Visual K. I get it, but I still consider them kind of like godfathers. Lunacy's music used to be so boring to me. I got one album from them a long, long, long time ago, and it was two songs. One is I For You. There's another song, I For You. I can't remember, but I know Eye for You was one of the songs. Ryuichi's voice just sounded so passionate and sincere and was so intense in that song. So I was like, damn, what they talk about? I was reading the lyrics and that song was so beautiful. I was just like, oh my God, I want this played at my wedding. Eventually I was like, okay, it's time to actually check out more of Lunacy's music. I started listening to them live and that just like bucktick changed my perspective of everything. I was just like, wow, this man sings with so much passion, so much expression. And I just love the way he performs with his whole body. There's no worrying about what his face looks like. He puts his whole soul into his singing. Some of the songs that I heard live, I didn't even know of. Some songs I would find live and then I would go back and listen to the album versions. I would be less satisfied, but I would still have more appreciation for album versions. A lot of the songs I like from Lunacy don't sound very dated when you listen to the tracks in comparison to Bucktick, where everything sounds super duper old. I'm assuming, I gotta look up the times and stuff, I'm assuming that Bucktick is older than Lunacy. I feel like Bucktick is older. Despite me ripping into that person who said that they did not like Toshi's voice, my biggest thing with X Japan was that I only liked the slow songs. I've made videos on here talking about me discovering like different bands and I can't always recall things super accurately, but I'm pretty sure I got into X Japan more or decided to dive into their music more when I watched X1999. I had X1999 on VHS. I had gotten it from a thrift store. They had Forever Love as a song and I was like, this is X Japan. I'd never heard this song before. This is very beautiful. So I started checking out a lot of their music and the only ones that stuck for me were the slow songs. The singing piano ballad. Now that I'm older, I cannot for the life of me tell you why I suddenly am able to enjoy X Japan's more upbeat songs, but I am. It was like a switch and this also happened during high school. I think overall in high school, I gained an appreciation for older sounding bands period because I was going through this with older American rock bands as well. I made friends with a whole bunch of guys who exclusively listened to old rock. So around that time I was discovering a lot of different old rock bands and I think that's the reason why my taste opened up to even the old Japanese rock bands. High school was definitely super different than middle school where I was just listening to what emo, nu metal, like there was a certain type of rock I was more apt to listening to and just cut off everything else. I think my favorite song right now that I've been listening to is Jade. Jade was a song I didn't really care for at first. I did not like that song at all, actually. Within the past 2 or 3 years, I've been listening to Jade more. It's crazy how your ears can open up more as you get older. So now that we've gotten that cluster out of the way, like those three old bands, we're gonna talk about one that's not in that super old cluster. I was a huge Ayabie girly. Like, I loved Ayabie. It was one of my favorite Visual K bands at a certain point of time. So when Ryohei left, it was like a smack in the face. I was like, what are you doing? Why are you leaving? And then finding out that he went and he was in Megamasso, I was like, absolutely not. You need to go back to Ayabie. What are you doing? That is 11, 12 year old immaturity. Okay, that's what that is. For a while, I didn't listen to anything Megamasso. And then eventually I had a change of heart. I was like, okay, I did like Ryohei. I thought he was cute. So I was like, you know what? Let me go to Megamasso. They're probably not that good anyways. I ended up enjoying some of Megamasso's music, but what really got me is the members. The members really made Megamasso for me. Ryohei looked super happy and Zargi was really cool. Go was hot. I had a huge crush on Go. He was so funny. So yeah, Megamasso grew on me. I think it's stupid now that I'm older for me to have those type of hangups to where it's like, nope, I'm not gonna listen to the next band you go to. If anything, now that I'm an adult, I actually get excited when somebody leaves and goes to a different band because a lot of times some of these people leave and like quit music or they just disappear forever. Say they're
there's like some conflicts and stuff going on and the band can't stay together, like members want to leave, I consider it an honor them going to another band where you can actually still experience them being involved in music. My outlook on that has changed completely. Preteen me was not having it. I was like, allegiance comes first, buddy. Allegiance comes first. Why are you not in Ayabie? I'm not listening to your new band, fam. So that's where I was with Megamasso. And now I would say I'm kind of like a decent fan of Megamasso. They're not my favorite group in the world, but I do have a lot of songs I like by them. I'm glad I grew out of that because a lot of the bands I was into ended up splitting and the members ended up in other bands. And here we are now. It's almost like it's inevitable. Hate to do the same thing twice, but the next band we're going to discuss, it was a similar thing that happened. This sounds so stupid now that I'm talking about it. Before I discovered Versailles, I discovered Hizaki Grace Project. Juka was the vocalist, and I was content with that. I was loving everything that Hizaki Grace Project was putting out. Juka on vocals, loved everything about it. When I found out that Hizaki was in Versailles or had joined Versailles, I was just like, what is this Versailles? Why did he do that? Why didn't he just make way more music under Hizaki Grace Project with Juka as vocals? 12-year-old me was not feeling it. So I was just like, you know what? I'm just not going to listen to Versailles out of spite. And that's what I did. It didn't take that long before I finally listened because I was kind of missing the sound. So I was like, okay, let's see if Versailles sounds anything similar to Hizaki Grace Project and go from there, make my judgments there. It felt like it was in the same realm of music. Kamijo happened and I was just like, oh my God, he has such a nice voice. Then I was just like, wait a second, this is life-changing. This is life-changing stuff right here. I think I was pulled more easily into Versailles compared to all the other groups on this list. I started diving into Versailles' albums as they would come out. I would listen to them from beginning to end. I was really into like symphonic rock, specifically symphonic rock in Visual K for a while. Like I went through a period where I could not get enough of this stuff. Now I'm like, okay, I've had enough. similar to metalcore, like those two things, symphonic metal and metalcore, I'm good. You really gotta be doing something crazy to stand out. I have a lot of respect for the members, but I don't listen to a lot of Versailles as much anymore. I've just listened to them so much, so much Versailles, and there's still no bands like them. I'm glad I gave them a listen and didn't just hold the grudge until adulthood. We're gonna move on to a group that's kind of like in the same realm. It's considered power metal. Is it? I don't know. When Matt and Row Opera came out, the music played and I was just like, this music sounds so freaking awesome. I've been waiting for this my entire life. Who are these people? Because I really loved the way the music was composed. But Sono's vocals, I could not stand Sono's vocals. It was literally a struggle for me to sit through a song because I did not like his vocals at certain points of the song. It would grind my ears. The music perfect, his voice sometimes perfect, but then there were certain notes he would hit where I'd be like, okay, that's a wrap. Like the I can't. I think it was Anime, I think is the name of the album. When Anime came out, I listened to that entire album and I remember turned it on, loved the music, did not like a lot of Sono's vocals in much of the album. I'm listening to the song, I'm enjoying the song, but if only it was a different vocal. Obviously, vocalists put a lot of work into being in these bands, but I could not stand Sono's voice. That is the reason why I did not like Matt and Row Opera. I was like, I really wish y'all could have had a different vocalist because musically, this is everything that I want. I'm happy that that did not change, first of all, because that's extremely disrespectful. Also, Sono's vocals have improved so much. I would say probably within the past 2 years that I've been revisiting Matt and Row Opera's music, I've realized that Sono's voice doesn't bother me anymore. And I don't think that it's just me. I think it's a combination of him being a far better vocalist than he was when he first started. That man has been putting in the work in his vocals because I was listening to one of their more recent songs. I just like this song a lot and his voice doesn't bother me at all. And I know it's not just me. Like, you guys tell me if you're a Matt and Row Opera listener, I think Sono's vocals has improved so much. so much. I'm just gonna say power metal or metal in general. When you're in that realm of music, a lot of the vocalists really try to improve as best as they can. I think improving vocally is just natural when you keep doing it over and over again. But I think there's been a lot of intentional improvement put into his voice, and it's amazing to see. I cleared it up. Hopefully nobody will tear into me. I'm sorry. I just could not do it. I could not do it in the past, but it's okay. I still like Dulce. His voice isn't that bad in Dulce. There's only a couple parts that I don't appreciate as much as the rest of the song. Honestly, it's not the worst. It doesn't show as badly in that song. If you guys have any recommendations for any Matt and Ro Apra songs you like, comment it. I will check it out because I really do like the music. And now that the vocals have gotten a certain point, like, good job, Sono. Good job. Last but not least, we're gonna go to the last band, and then I'm gonna go get some food because my stomach has been growling nonstop. My voice is hoarse because I need some water. The last band is The Gazette. The Gazette was actually a discussion in the forum that I was in where they were talking crap about XJAPAN. Somebody brought up The Gazette and how they could not get into any of their music, and it knocked me back into like 2006, 2007, to where I too could not get into The Gazette's music. I've told this story a million times. My sole purpose as somebody being in Gazette territory was to collect pictures of Rata. That's all I wanted to do with my time, is collect as many pictures of Rata in my photo bucket as possible. And then I finally got into them. The song that got me into them was Toguro. Toguro, I feel like listening to now, don't get me wrong, I adore Toguro, but compared to their discography of music, especially like their older stuff, is not all that. For some reason, Toguro was the song that got me though. I came across Toguro by mistake. And when I heard Toguro, I was like, is this The Gazette? Like, who is this singing? And that made me go and actually start listening to their albums instead of just watching their PVs. Don't ask me how I managed to escape the grasps of Filth and the Beauty. I don't know how I listened to Filth and the Beauty and Gurren and didn't take interest in The Gazette, but I think I just had like two or three songs that I really liked. It's very weird talking about The Gazette now because of how much of their music I consume. Even conceptualizing there being a point where I didn't really care for them is wild. And it's even funnier thinking about the timeline of who like my favorite members were as far as like being in love, like being a girl. I was so into Rata, and then it moved to Ruki. When I actually started listening to The Gazette, Ruki became my obsession. Then after seeing them live, where was I for Uduha, man? I wasn't even checking for Uduha at all. But then when I saw him live performing and the way he smiles and how vibrant he is, Uduha is absolutely magnetizing. I hope his wife is happy. That man is fine, and he just seems like he has a lot of positive energy. The aura he gives off is incredible. So that's who I'm really into now, Uduha. I've been collecting lots of pictures of him privately, not on Tumblr, but it's just crazy. Didn't pay Uduha any attention when I was a kid. I didn't just, it's like he didn't even exist. And that's crazy because I look back at the older pictures and Uduha looks good. I think I thought Uduha looked super girly, and that's crazy because we're talking about Visual K, but, and I liked Yumihito from Ayabie, so that wouldn't make any sense. I'm trying to get it together in my head, but that's not the point of the video. Yeah, that completes everything. That's all the bands I have to talk about. I tried to think if maybe there are some other bands. They're not really worth mentioning as much. Dimlin was a band I wasn't really into at first, but I was able to get into them through their newer stuff because Dimlin had such a change in sound. I was like, nah, they're not really worth putting on this list. This covers everything. Let me know which groups you guys couldn't get into. Remember, groups you couldn't get into but are now into. Don't go in my comments shredding these groups. XJAPAN sucks. The Gazette sucks. I don't know why they're so popular. No, let's talk about groups that you did not like at first, but you like now. That's a nice thing to talk about. I have put Matt and Ro on this opera. Wow. Matt and Ro on this opera. What are we thinking? Wow.